Just move on up toward your destination. Though you may find from time to time complication. And take the trip. Though there may be wet road ahead and you cannot slip, just move on up, for peace you'll find. Into the steeple of beautiful people where there's only one kind. So hush now, child, and don't cry. Understand you by and by. Move on up and keep on wishing. Remember your dream is your only scheme, so keep on pushing. Take nothing less than the supreme best. Do not obey, rumors be forsaken, but you can pass the test. Just move on up to a greater day. With just a little faith, if you put your mind to it, you can surely do it. Just move on up. We move on up. Move on up.
I know here you're in trouble. Gloria says about 30% are unemployed. That's why I'm working hard to get this surplus food here. Some of you say to me, well, I'm not like you. I'm not a congressman. I haven't got education. I haven't got work. But you're a human being. And you know what you've got? You've got in your hand the power to use your vote and to use even those few cents you get from welfare to spend them only where you want to spend them. Remember that. A young slave boy stood one day before the greatest ruler of his day And God said to Moses, "What's in your hand?" And Moses said, "Lord, only I've got a stick, that's all." He said, "Well, let me use what's in your hand." And God used that slave boy with a stick in his hand to divide the Red Seas, march through a wilderness, bring water out of rocks, manna from heaven, and bring his people to freedom land. What's in your hand? What's in your hand? George Washington Carver, who was so frail that he was traded for a broken-down horse as a slave boy. And George Washington Carver, sitting in the science laboratory at Tuskegee, told me, he said, "Dr. Powell," he said, "I just go out on the fields each morning at 5 o'clock, and I let God guide me. And I bring back these little things and work them over my laboratory." And that man did more to revolutionize the agricultural science of peanuts and of cotton and sweet potato than any other human being in the field of agricultural science. What's in your hand? Just let God use you, that's all. What's in your hand? I've got a string in my hand, that's all, and I'm flying a kite. And way up in the heavens, lightning strikes it, and I, Benjamin Franklin, discover for the first time the possibilities of electricity with a string in my hand. What's in your hand? Little hunchback sitting in a Roman jail. I haven't got anything in my hand but an old quill pen, but God says, write what I tell you to write. And Paul wrote, "I have run my race with patience. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there's laid up to me a crown of glory." What's in your hand, little boy? All I've got is a slingshot. And the enemies of my people are great and big and more numerous than we are. Well, little David, go down to the brook and pick out a few stones and come on back and close your eyes if you want to and pull back that slingshot and let him go. And David killed the biggest enemy, the leader of the giants, against his people, and his people became free, just letting God guide a stone in his hand. And a few years passed and David is a king. And God says, "What's in your hand?" He said, "I've got a harp in my hand." He said, "Well, David, play on your harp." And he played, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Maketh me to lie down in green pastures. Leadeth me beside still waters. Yea, though I walk through the valley in the shadow of death, I fear no evil." What's in your hand? What's in your hand? Man hanging on a cross. I've got two nails in my hand. Father, I stretch my hands to thee. No other help I know. If thou withdrawest thyself from me, whither shall I go? And that man, with two nails in his hand, split history in half, B.C. and A.D. And what's in your hand tonight, people of Cambridge? You've got God in your hand, and he'll let you win, because he's on your side and one with God, always in the majority. So walk with him, and talk with him, and work with him, and stick together, and fight together. And with God's hand in your hand, the victory will be accomplished here sooner than you dreamed, sooner than you hoped, sooner than you prayed for, sooner than you imagined. Good night, and God bless you.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, that was Sly Stone really getting it rolling there. Sly Stone is, I think Sly was on to something. He was really, really on to something. He had an amazing band. He made some amazing music. And here you go, Sly Stone.
Yeah.
Wow, ladies and gentlemen, that was Sly Stone. I wonder what message was Sly trying to deliver in that song, Everyday People. I think we all everyday people. Even the so-called celebrities, I think they're everyday people too. They just have just accomplished things. But what I would like to see, what the so-called everyday people realize that they're just as great as any celebrity or anybody of notoriety. Just got to realize what's in your hand. There it is. What's in your hand. And what's in my hand today, I have an amazing guest. She's been here before. She's awesome. She's amazing. She's dynamic. And she's always sharing some wonderful principles. She is a professional organizer, a motivational coach. She's in good standing with the NAPO, which stands for National Association of Professional Organizers. She also teaches lifestyle management and all these amazing things, time management too, all that. And her website is Create New Order. And my guest today, Jennifer Ryan. Jennifer, good morning, Jennifer. How you doing this morning?
Good morning, Rick. How are you?
I'm feeling amazing now.
Now, right now.
Because I got it's about now. It's about right now. It's not about 5 minutes ago what happened. It's about right now, being in the now. So I'm feeling amazing. But I want to know from you, how do you have fun? What's fun for you?
You know, that's a great question. What's fun for me? Well, I have fun when I'm active. I have fun when I'm social. I have fun relieving stress, actually. You know, the comic relief when things are getting crazy, you know, finding something to laugh about or something to do that's just fun. Go take a walk, appreciate what you see, laugh. Laughing is fun. There's nothing better than that, a good laugh and telling stories and sharing information. That's fun for me. I love to learn about people and what they're doing, and then I love to share that with other people. That's
okay.
Fun.
Okay, that's
besides
fun.
Besides my activities. I now, dance and play tennis and cycle and, you know, walk the dog. Those are fun, too.
Okay. And what brings you joy?
What brings me joy?
Because fun and joy, I think they're similar but different.
Yeah, they are. Well, you know, my grandson's laughter, my children's peace, that brings me joy. A sunny day by the beach.
Okay.
Oh, there is nothing more joyful to me.
Wow.
Those moments.
You mean with all the chaos going on in the city, and here you are on the beach relaxing.
And all you need is 5 minutes. All you need is 5 minutes. Take the 5 minutes and do it. You know, we all talk about how stressed we are and we don't have time. You don't need a day to go to the beach. Take a ride and go to the water, even if it's not the beach. Go sit by the water. Go sit by a fountain. Take a few minutes and just decompress. Get out of your head and the moment of the stress and the chaos. You know, I read something this morning as I was getting ready to come to the show, and I read depression is living in the past, anxiety is living in the future, and peace is living in the moment. And that's what you just said, that you're good right now because you're here and it's a good feeling and it's a good day and you're feeling really positive. It takes a moment to readjust and just breathe. Just go sit by the water. Get a cup of coffee. Take a walk around the block and just really release it. That's a good thing.
Now, you said something about water. I'm going to play something real quick. Let's see if this is relevant to what you just said. Or you tell me if it is.
This is what it is, okay? I said, empty your mind. Be formless, shapeless, like water. Now, you put water into a cup, it becomes the cup. You put water into a bottle, it becomes the bottle. You put it in a teapot, it becomes the teapot. Now, water can flow or it can crash. Be water, my friend.
That's remarkable. I never saw that clip before.
Do you know who that is?
As Bruce Lee.
Bruce Lee.
That's fantastic.
The legendary Bruce Lee.
And that's a lesson. That's a real lesson because it's true.
Be like water, my friend. Be like water.
Let it be.
Water takes the shape of the cup. And then he said it could be powerful. Yes. It could crash.
Yes. And let it flow.
Mm.
Let it flow. So it doesn't take shape. Everything that we do has to take shape.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't want it to take shape. Mm-hmm. And I think that's why we get this struggling feeling.
Speaking of taking shape, what does a professional organizer do?
We clear the clutter between the ears. And then we work on the stuff that surrounds it.
Wow.
Yes. Well, at least that's my motivation.
Wow. That's interesting.
That's where it all starts.
Interesting.
What surrounds us is what we create. And being a lifestyle designer, and that's what I am. I help you design that lifestyle that you want.
It's interesting that you say that because if you take someone and you take their clutter away and put them in a clean space, it won't be long before that space will be cluttered again.
That's correct.
At some point in time.
That's correct.
Interesting.
Yes. So you got to start between the ears. That's what's going on.
Now, what is it about stuff that people don't play with people's stuff?
They're attached
to it. It's called stuff.
It's called stuff. And they're just attached to it. And they think it makes them feel better.
Mm-hmm.
And in most cases, it makes them feel worse. And it does it complete opposite. What I found over the years is that people collect stuff to somehow comfort themselves or protect themselves. That's what happens with their stuff. They think that's what's happening. And then what it does is it overwhelms them. And then they're not happy with all that stuff that surrounds them. It doesn't make them feel good to see it, to have to deal with it. And then they don't deal with it. They ignore it. When we don't want to see something, we don't see something, right? Think about that. When we don't want to see maybe something that we're weak in, we have a weakness. And what is that weakness? One of my weaknesses is that I don't play tennis really well, but I'm not giving up and I'm getting better. I'm improving. I don't want to see where my lack of ability is, but unless I look at it, I can't improve it.
So what you're telling me is that you want to play in the U.S. Open? Is that?
I don't think that's ever going to happen.
Wimbledon?
I'll go and watch the U.S. Open. You know what I want to be able to do? I want to be able to win a game on a court with somebody who's a good match for me to play. Somebody who challenges me to work harder, but isn't going to cream me to make me feel bad about myself.
What you need to help you improve your tennis game is to take up a boxing game. Because that boxing will give you exactly what you need to help you improve in tennis. That's the thing about boxing. It helps you in other areas.
Right.
That's the one sport that will really help you in other areas because of the type of workout it is. Because it's upper body, it's movement, it's thinking, it's quick, repetition.
And here's what's important, right, is that we don't give up.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Right.
That we don't give up, that we keep going forward, that we keep working harder, that we keep trying. It's not always about getting there. It's about that energy to keep trying and to keep going and to try to get to that next step, no matter how hard it is.
Well, how about this? I don't know if this fits with what you're saying. Mm-hmm. What if you just, instead of saying, I mean, you want to practice and you're going to work hard and you want to get better. But what if you just said, you know what? I'm just having fun. I'm just enjoying myself. What about that?
That's a big part of it. That's a big part of it because sometimes when I don't do well, when I don't play well or, I feel like I should be better. I should have been able to hit that shot. I shouldn't have missed that shot.
Mm-hmm.
That's when I readjust and say, you know what? This is about fun and this is about improving. That's what this is about. And when you readjust that way, it's better. And you work harder, but you enjoy yourself as well. It's important to do that.
Do you know anything about basketball?
I don't know anything about basketball.
Okay. Because there was this guy named Kobe Bryant.
Mm-hmm.
And he just retired. He just played his last game. He played 20 years. It went by like that. It seemed like he just started the other
20
day.
20 years?
Wow. Went by. Yeah. So he had his last game. And he hadn't been playing well this year. He had a lot of injuries the last few years, and he's been struggling on the court. But he was a good player. He won 5 championships. And this last game, this is okay. This is the final game. They have the party at the in L.A. at the stadium there. Right. All the basketball players came out to see him off. Celebrities. This guy scored 60 points. Last game, 60. that was pretty good. And you know he modeled like Michael Jordan. He admired Michael Jordan. Mm-hmm. But that was pretty, 60 points. That was pretty cool.
Yes.
You know, at 30, I think he's 37. Wow. And he scored 60 points. But he's a hard worker. He worked really hard at his craft. He would go to the gym early and shoot, practice, because he wanted to be like Mike.
Right.
I want to be like Mike.
Right. So he set himself up for a challenge. He put a goal in front of him, and he competed with himself.
Yeah.
He competed with himself, and that's important. Instead of competing with other people, we have to compete with ourselves. What is going to make us better for ourselves today? And what gives that peace? You know, when I started my company, I sat down and I wrote down what my goals were. And oftentimes, when people start out on a venture, whether it's a new job or to start their own company, their definition of success usually includes money. You know, I want to make a lot of money. I want to be successful. I want to be famous. And one of the things that actually was the top thing that I put on my list of what will make me successful is to find peace. That was my top goal, was to find peace. And in my adventures and my venture of creating my business and creating my life, because I created my life the way I wanted my life to be, I have found peace. Does that mean I'm always peaceful? No.
So what happens when you go out and someone does something, out of...
Give me an example. Like, what would they do?
I don't know. Something that will annoy you.
Right. Right.
Do you let that break your peace? And how do you not let that break your peace?
I will say that sometimes it will begin to break my peace. And then I remember. And then I remind myself. And I recenter myself that was about them, not about me.
Okay.
That because it's not about me. I'm solid in understanding what I know, and I know I don't know everything.
Okay.
So I'm solid in knowing that. So when somebody does something that I initially begin to react to, I stop that reaction. And I think about what just happened so that I can understand what was that about.
So I want to challenge you.
Okay.
Because, is that also important, like challenging yourself? You say compete against yourself. What's the difference between competing against yourself and challenging yourself?
Competing against yourself is looking at where you are and then working harder to beat where you are.
Okay.
Okay, that's how you compete with yourself. To challenge yourself is to put something in front of you that is scary, that's risky, that doesn't seem super possible. You put that in front of you and say, I'm going to do this.
Okay.
Make that decision to say, I'm going to do this. And I may not make it. I may not get it done, but I'm going to attempt it.
So here's my challenge to you. Mm-hmm. And to you. You and I are going to do this.
Okay.
We're going to go 24 hours of peace. That means you're out, you're about. You're not sitting in a home in a room with the door closed.
Right.
You're out amongst people. Mm-hmm. And people are doing stuff that annoys you. They're doing whatever they do. They're smoking or they're cutting you off or they're doing this, they're doing that. But you are 24 hours apiece. 24
I'll
hours.
I'll take that challenge.
Okay.
I will take that challenge.
So we kind of started the day already, or could we just finish the day off? And
why today? Not start right now?
Okay.
We'll start right now, and then we'll go from now to 24 hours from now.
24 hours apiece.
Right.
And I'll text you and see how you did.
Uh-huh.
If you run into a challenge, I'll...
Right.
If I run into a challenge, I'll text you.
Uh-huh.
How I handled it. But 24 hours apiece.
Why don't we have a little more fun with this?
I'm listening.
Why don't we take a little bit of selfie video and exchange the selfie video with each other?
How do you mean?
So if something happens that challenges me, right, and tries to break me from my center and break me from my peace, I'll do a little video clip, like 30 seconds, of what just happened, and I'll send it to you. And maybe where we are.
Okay.
And what just happened.
Okay.
Let's try that.
Yeah.
Let's see if that'll work.
Yeah.
You know, and maybe with the listeners, we can pop it up on something. They could take a look at some of them.
So what's today, April 14th?
They could share it with us. April 14th. It's a very good day, and it's a Friday. Sometimes Fridays can be chaotic, and sometimes Fridays can be real fast because people want to rush and get it done. Mm-hmm. It's going to be a great weekend. I understand the weather's going to be nice.
Yeah. Speaking of Friday, Sybil is having a financial day.
Mm-hmm.
Sybil Library.
Right.
And it's open to the public. It's free. They have an all. It's going to start at 10 o'clock in the morning, go all the way to 5.
Oh.
Yeah. They're going to be educating you on money management, all different areas of money.
Fantastic.
Yeah. And it's free.
Right.
To the public. I'm going to go get the flyer when I get a moment.
Yes.
You know, so I could read it off. But that's what's happening.
So people know where to go.
Yeah.
Which branch is it?
Sybil. Yeah, which is on 30 Madison Avenue between 34th and 35th Street.
Excellent.
Right in the middle of the block, and it's going to be great. Anytime you get knowledge and wisdom and you learn things,
mm-hmm.
and I think like a lot of people are having challenges with money now.
Right.
It can't hurt.
No. You know
what? Take a Saturday. I mean, no, it's a Friday. So right. take that Friday.
Listen, if you learn one more thing.
How about that?
Sometimes it's just about one more thing.
How about? Or you might meet someone.
That's important.
And I'm going to go back to basketball again.
Mm-hmm.
There's a team called the Golden State Warriors. Now, you say you don't watch basketball, right?
Right.
I want to recommend that you watch this team because this team is special. It's something that they're doing. That's really, first of all, they've done something that's never been done before. They won more games in the history of the NBA. They broke Michael Jordan's record.
Really?
Michael Jordan had a year, I think it was 95, 96. They won 72 games. They played 82. They won 72 out of 82 games.
Wow.
So they was 72-10, the Chicago Bulls, Michael Jordan. They was balling. They was playing some serious basketball. And they was playing team ball because you have to play team ball. So now, heck on this team, the Golden State Warriors.
Mm-hmm.
Got this little guy, Steph Curry. We got to call him little. He's like 6'3", but he looks so tiny out there.
Compared to the rest, right?
And this guy's playing exceptional basketball. But they all playing together as a team. And he always gives credit to his team. He's like the star, he's a main attraction to the team. He's a focal point of the team.
Mm-hmm.
But they all are doing great. And they play together. And they played. And they won 73 games and lost only 9.
Wow.
They only played 82 games.
Wow.
And some of those 9, they could, you know, they lost to teams that weren't that good. So for whatever reason, I don't know what happened. They only lost to one good team. Or two good teams. But the rest, they should have beaten those. So they could have been 80-2.
Right.
Pretty much.
Right.
They'd have won those, because those 7 teams were nowhere near better. They're just a day. It was just a day. But they're doing something special. I think if people lived their life the way the Warriors are playing basketball, man, we would do some amazing things.
We would. I think what you said is really important. Team ball. They played team ball.
Yes.
And we forget every day. There's a whole big world out there. We encounter people all the time that are very much like us. They have their own struggles and their own thoughts and their own, you know, their own box of rocks, as I call it. You know, and we forget this. We think we're an individual out there fighting the fight. There's no fight.
Mm-hmm.
We're together. Everybody's together. you know, and take a moment and pay attention to that. You know, I'm a Starbucks fan. I go into Starbucks and I get coffee. And the people that work at Starbucks, sometimes they get frustrated. They're busy people. That place is crazy busy. And sometimes you come to the counter and you can see them worn out. Smile at them. They're going to make a really good cup of coffee for you. You know, it's, yeah, you're paying for it, but smile at them. I never fail to get one back. Just give, you know, give somebody a break. Smile at them. Can't hurt. You'll see. It makes a difference to people. You're in this together. It's not just about you. It's about everybody. Mm-hmm. So if we try to really pay attention to that and be grateful for that, that'll give you peace.
But everybody don't have the knowledge that you have to work with. They might not have the experiences that you have or the teaching that you have.
That's right. It took a long time to get here.
They might not have heard what you've heard.
Right.
They might not have sit down and listened to a Wayne Dyer. Right. Or Les Brown or some motivational champion or some success person or some. They might not have heard that.
No, they may not. But I think it's human nature that we forget. This world is busy. This world is fast. We're all plugged in all the time. Unplug.
There was a movie called Straight Out of Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. And the guy told his father, he said, "Boy, I ain't nothing. I ain't gonna never be nothing." And he said, "You are nothing and you ain't gonna never be nothing." Now imagine your father telling you that. Picture that.
That's heartbreaking.
And you know what he did? He went and robbed a drug dealer. That was the plan that he came up with, like, wow, we gotta get some money and I'm gonna make a difference. And so he went and robbed a drug dealer. That was the plan. Yeah.
Was he successful?
No, because they did. They got away.
Right.
But the results afterwards was terrible.
Uh-huh.
People got hurt because of that. And it wasn't a good thing that he did.
No, it wasn't a good thing that he did.
He was not successful. No.
But imagine if all the energy he put into making that plan to go and rob a drug dealer, he chose to do something good with that.
Right.
Instead.
Picture that.
So what it shows you is he had the power. It was a bad decision.
Yes.
So we do have the power. It's our decision-making sometimes that we can't get away from that you'll never be anything.
Yeah. So how does being organized help you with your
everyday
life?
Being organized frees you. It'll free you. Freedom. And, you know, some people feel...
Freedom.
Freedom is right. You know, some people feel that it's work. It's work to be organized. But it's work once. Then it's pleasure. Because you have a system and you have a routine. One of the things that is so important to us as people is a routine. Think about it. What you do every day, the first thing that you do every morning. What's really important to you? What's really important to you? I get up in the morning, pet my animals, feed them. It's the first thing I do every day is feed the animals. And then I pour myself a cup of coffee. Now, if I didn't have half of the belongings that I had, if I didn't have half of the little conveniences or things that are around me, those are the things that are most important to me. The rest of it doesn't get visited every day, isn't part of my everyday routine. It might surround me, and I love to be surrounded by beautiful things, but I don't want to be overwhelmed by them either.
Mm.
I want to enjoy them, and I want them to sustain me and give me that welcome home. But if I see things that overwhelm me, I don't want to walk through that door. And then I start to feel bad and weighted. That's how organizing your life. It makes everything effortless. It's effortless. Your keys go here. You never have to search for them. You know, your coats go here because that's where your coats are going to go. And it doesn't mean your coats have to go in the hallway closet. Like everybody else's coats go. You can put them in the closet in your bedroom if you want, if that's what makes you happy. Your environment is about you. It's not about anybody else. It's not about what the architect drew. It's about how you live and how you navigate your space. And that's what makes your life better.
Awesome. What is the definition of freedom?
For me, is peace.
Oh, it's freedom for you is peace.
Yeah.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. What is the definition of freedom? Wow, it's not coming up.
Siri's not answering you?
Well, this is not Siri.
Okay.
This is just Google.
Right. But what's the definition of freedom for you?
Oh, man. Fun.
There you go.
Fun.
There you go.
I like to have fun.
Uh-huh.
I think fun is freedom for me. And I see a lot of people hold that freedom, I mean that fun in.
They don't let it hang. Why do they do it? Why do you think people...
It's something psychological.
You know, that they don't just let it
loose.
It starts
from childhood.
You know?
It starts from childhood.
There was a campaign, and I have to say, I will take credit for this in my small little world. For years, I carried a box of clown noses in my car. And when I went to see clients who had a lot of stress, a lot of anxiety, I'd give them a clown nose.
Yeah.
So I put the clown nose on, and there were so many people. It took weeks to get me to put that clown, you know, to get them to put that clown nose on and just laugh and relax a little bit. And I don't know if we are self-conscious. We're afraid somebody's going to say something negative to us. But I have to tell you that being silly is it's such a gift to other people to be silly, you know, or to laugh or point something out, you know, about myself that might be funny or noticed by somebody who's unsure of me or how to navigate me and point it out and poke fun. It's knowing yourself and being confident in that. And I think many people aren't.
I'm going to tell you what just came up for me. This is a positive show. This is a motivational show.
Yes.
And I think what I'm about to say is about positivity and about motivation. But I think sometimes people forget that we're here not forever. How do you look at this thing called, they call it death?
Right.
Death. How do you look at that? And you're a very positive person, so how do you, how do you think of that? Like,
well, this is going to be an interesting answer, I think. I personally have had the privilege of being with three people when they passed.
Wow.
I have had a moment with three individuals. Two of them I knew, and one of them I did not. And I held their hand when they went.
Wow.
And I have to tell you that there is such an incredible grace in that moment.
Wow.
And I'm still emotional about it because I can see all three of their faces. And it's a grace. And it's the only way I can describe it to you. And I see death as I'm a spiritual person. I'm not a religious person. I pray. I ask for guidance, and I thank the universe and the angels, God, that I have the gifts that I have, and I ask for help when I need it. But death is your energy passing to another place, and it doesn't go away, in my opinion. I don't believe anybody ever leaves us. I think we're all a big part of one. So for me, death is natural. It's part of our cycle.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Ladies and gentlemen, Rick Young, another segment of What's in Your Hand here at WHCR 90.3 FM, The Voice of Harlem. This is What's in Your Hand, and my name is Rick Young again. And my guest today, Jennifer Ryan, who is a professional organizer, motivational coach. And the book is coming out. The book is titled...
It is Famous for 5 Minutes, and it's being marketed now. And we're keeping our fingers crossed that it's going to be picked up and published and be out shortly. I'll be at New York Public Library. I have some upcoming dates I want to let you know about in May and June. So I'll be speaking at the Hudson branch on May 10th, And I'll be at the Yorkville branch on May 14th.
Yeah.
So I'll be speaking about organizing and lifestyle design and all those good things. And we'll be talking about the book as well. And hopefully by then we'll have some answers.
Okay.
So we'll see how that goes.
The library.
Yes.
What's so special about the library? If it's so special, mm-hmm. why don't more people go to the library? But
you know, I think our ever-changing world, our libraries aren't the first thought for leisure and adventure and knowledge. You know, Google's our first thought. Google it. You know, it's quick, it's easy, it's in our hand. But the libraries have everything you could possibly want to know or learn. And it's a place to adventure. It's a place to help you build whatever life you want to build. You have resources there that you go in and you look around and you might be attracted to something that you never thought of before. You know, and they have great programs, if I do say so myself, where you can go and be there for an hour or two and learn something from somebody who experiences something you want to know about, like professional organizing or boxing or motivation or, you know, learning about movies or learning about how to research history or your genealogy. So the library gives you those programs that you hear firsthand from somebody who knows about a topic. Not just practices the topic, but, you know, I've learned more from my clients than I think I've ever taught them. Honestly, I learn from everybody, and I strive to learn from everybody.
How did you get to be a speaker in the library?
I actually probably about, it's almost 20 years, my goodness.
In the library?
Libraries on Long Island. I was invited to speak. I belong to a networking group.
Mm-hmm.
And in the networking group, a programmer for the library came to the networking group. And met me, and she said, would you be interested in doing a program for the library? And I did one program, and from there, it has not stopped. I've been doing it now for nearly 20 years, and I do programs, Long Island, New Jersey,
and you don't
New
get
York
paid
Public
for that.
Library. There are some library honorariums that I do get paid for, some
oh,
I do
nice.
Not.
That's nice.
And, but mostly, it's a public service. That's really what it's about. But I owe the library. I owe it. Since I'm a child, the library has been my respite. That is where I go because I always wanted more information. I always wanted to learn more. I was always reaching for more, 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 more. And the library is where I found it because I could find out anything I want to know in the library. And I guess in today's world, I might be considered old-fashioned, but I love the book. I love audio books. I love my Kindle, but I love the book. I want to touch the book. I want to read the book, turn the page. You know, I want to know in my hand what's in your hand,
right.
The book.
That's right.
You know, it gives you so much. I enjoy it. So the library is still a place where I want to go and get.
What would you say to someone that would rather watch TV or tell live vision?
Mm-hmm.
Tell live vision.
Yes.
Or read a book. What would you say to that person that would rather watch TV than read?
Turn off the TV. I've been saying this in my lectures for years and years and years. A lot of my clients get hooked on the television to avoid other things. They're also hearing on television so many negative things. You know, I don't get television. I don't subscribe to it anymore. And if I want to watch something and enjoy a program, I stream it. And I get my news from the internet or from radio. I listen to the radio to traffic and weather, you know. But really, if I want to know what's going on outside, I look out my window. I don't subscribe to TV anymore. And it's been about 3 years since I gave up television. And when I moved recently, they gave me a package when I got my internet. They said, we'll give you TV free for a year or something. I don't know, whatever. And we got TV. I turned it in. I couldn't stand it. I was starting to feel stressed. I was starting to feel anxiety. I was starting to feel like there was this static in the air.
Wow.
And I said, this has got to go. And it's the advertising telling me.
And some people would feel the opposite if they didn't have TV.
You know what? It took when I first shut it off, it took a couple of weeks to really kind of come down off of it. It really did. It physically didn't feel good. I didn't know what to do with myself. The routine was to turn the TV on in the morning and watch, you know, whatever news program, or in the evening. And, you know, you just sort of spend 2 hours, 3 hours in front of the TV on the couch. My thing was, I started to think about it, and I want to live my life. I don't want to watch other people live a life that isn't true.
There's a program that comes on Sunday morning. It's called CBS Sunday Morning.
Yes.
I really like that program.
I miss that program.
Charles Osgood. Osgood.
Yes.
I mean, you learn things. Mm-hmm. I mean, I want to watch where I'm learning something.
Right.
I don't want to see, like.
That's a very good program. And I miss programs like that. But you're still getting advertising in between there.
Yeah.
You know, and that advertising, sometimes you look at that advertising, and honestly, when I had TV a few months ago, the advertising was for prescription medications, food that wasn't good for you, and there was something else. So food that wasn't good for you, prescription medication, oh, and home improvements. So that was the advertising that I saw coming at me constantly. And I thought to myself, if you eliminate the foods that aren't good for you that are being advertised to you, maybe half of that prescription medication isn't going to be necessary.
Yeah.
You know, and is home improvements really our biggest leisure activity today? Home improvements? I get out of the box. Get out of the box. Go outside and play. I don't care how old you are. I don't care what shape you're in. Go outside and play. Turn that thing off.
Yeah. So, Jennifer, people are moving in,
mm-hmm.
and people are moving out. Mm-hmm. Why? Maybe it's the color of their skin.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, you can run, and you can run, but you can't hide.
Mm-hmm.
Because they say it's an eye for an eye or two for two. And if you vote for me, I'll set you free. That's a rap. That's a rap. Mm-hmm. on, brother, rap on.
Right.
And they say the only one talking about love thy brother is the preacher. And the only person a steady learning is the teacher. That's a song
mm-hmm.
by the Mighty. Well, I can't call them Mighty because Mighty is the OJs. But the Temptations, the tempting temptations. I want to play that song for you. Do you mind if I play that song for you?
Play that song.
Ball of confusion. That's what the world is today. Yeah, yeah. They got the guy with the light voice,
mm-hmm.
Eddie Kendrick. They got the guy with the deep voice, Melvin. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Great, great.
Everything.
And the band played on.
fear in the air, tension everywhere. Unemployment rising fast, the Beatles' new records of gas.
And the only safe place to live is on an Indian reservation.
And the band played on.
Eve of destruction, tax deduction.
City inspectors, bill collectors,
hardcore Indian man, population out of hand.
Suicide, too many bills, hippies moving to the hill. People all over the world are shouting in the war.
And the band played on.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
And that was the Temptations. Wow, Boiler Confusion. It's so amazing how a lot of that song was done in the 70s, and it's so a lot of it is going on right now. It's relevant today. Isn't that amazing? I'm gonna take a quick break, and I will be right back. And got some more. What's in your hand? More amazing show left for you. Wow, so cool.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Welcome to WHCR's Community Calendar, keeping you abreast of events in Harlem and throughout the tri-state area. The following events will take place from Thursday, April 7th to Friday, April 15th, 2016. This Thursday, April 7th, from 8 p.m. to 10 p.m. at the Malcolm X and Dr. Betty Shabazz Center is the start of Art Foro, a three-day art fair hosted by the publication of the same name. This will be the first fair exclusively showcasing work by Dominican artists in Northern Manhattan. For ticket information, call 917-325-2564. On Friday, April 8th at 6:30 p.m. at Bishop Perry Hall is Harlem After Work Salsa. This is a long-running classic salsa event catering mainly to a mature crowd, featuring plenty of classic salsa and cha-cha. For ticket information, visit harlemsalsa.com. On Tuesday, April 12th at 6 p.m. at the Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center is a free seminar by Cancer Smart called Breast Health. Do you know the facts? Join them to hear expert insight on breast cancer screening guidelines and discussions about the role nutrition can play in breast health and cancer prevention. For more information on this free event, visit cancersmart.org. On Thursday, April 14th, from 6 p.m. to 7:30 at the Harlem Hospital is the Harlem Town Hall, where you can attend to learn about guaranteed health care for all New Yorkers. If you worry about the cost of healthcare or other issues surrounding care and medication, attend the meeting to hear about a better way to approach healthcare in New York State. For more information, visit nyhcampaign.org. If you have an event that you would like to place on our calendar, please call 212-650-7481 or email communitycalendar@whcr.org. Submissions must be made 3 to 4 weeks prior to the event. This is Huma Saida for WHCR 90.3 FM, the voice of Harlem.
On Saturday, May 28th at 4 p.m., Dr. Ruth Singletary at Flying High Gospel presents the World Evangelical Deliverance Center's Renovation Service. The service will feature the fantastic violinaires of Detroit, Michigan, the gospel keynotes of Tyler, Texas, the Blind Boys of Mississippi, the Swanee Quintet of Augusta, GA, the Soul Savers of North Carolina, and many of your local favorite groups. Your host for the evening will be yours truly, Brother Bill of WHCR 90.3 FM. Now, that's the World Evangelical Deliverance Center's Renovation Service, held at New Covenant Temple Church, located at 1805 Amsterdam Avenue at 149th Street in the Kingdom of Harlem. Doors open at 3 p.m. Service starts at 4. For tickets and more information, call 347-346-8365. That's 347-346-8365.
This is your sister Daia, host of First Light and the Gardens of Tranquility and Contemplation.
And I'm Lamond Fenner, host of Lamond's Jazz Break at 8, inviting you to the third annual celebration of International Jazz Day on Saturday, April 30th, from 7 p.m. until 11 p.m.
International Jazz Day is the culmination of Jazz Appreciation Month, which draws public attention to jazz and its extraordinary heritage throughout the month of April.
And there will be a reception, an art exhibit, a multimedia presentation, a panel discussion, and of course, great, great jazz. At the center of the event is an awards presentation honoring WHCR 90.3 FM's jazz personalities.
That's the third annual International Jazz Day in Harlem, celebrated at the Dwyer, Saturday, April 30th, from 7 p.m. until 11 p.m. at the Dwyer Cultural Center, located at 258 St. Nicholas Avenue at 123rd Street in Harlem.
In celebration of WHCR's 30th anniversary, WHCR membership cardholders will receive a $5 discount off theater seating.
For tickets and more information, call 212-222-3060. That's 212-222-3060.
This summer, the City College of New York invites you to keep ahead of the course load. Summer at City is peak season for earning credits towards your degree. With classes taught by renowned faculty, over 300 courses to choose from, and three affordable sessions being offered, what better way to beat the heat? To register, visit City online at ccny.cuny.edu. Registration ends July 4th. Spend your summer at City.
WHCR is proud to have Viatex and Document Prep as an underwriter. Viatex, located at 600 West 139th Street between Broadway and Riverside Drive. Viatex is available to assist you with income tax, life insurance, immigration, translation, divorces, and notary. For hours of operation and more information, email viatex1040@gmail.com or call 212-926-5697.
Ninth annual celebration of World Tai Chi and Qigong Day will take place on Saturday, April 30th, starting at 10 a.m. World Tai Chi and Qigong Day will be held in two locations, St. Nicholas Park in Harlem and Mullally Park in the Bronx. St. Nicholas Park will offer Tai Chi and Qigong demonstrations, along with free Reiki, Qi Energy, and Reflexology consultations. Mullally Park will offer Tai Chi and Qigong sessions, a health extravaganza with alternative medicine, blood pressure testing, and emergency preparedness. That's World Tai Chi and Qigong Day on Saturday, April 30th, starting at 10 a.m. in two locations, St. Nicholas Park, located at 135th Street and St. Nicholas Avenue in Harlem, and Mullally Park, located at Jerome Avenue and 164th Street across from Yankee Stadium. World Tai Chi and Qigong Day is free and open to the public.
This is Reverend Calvin Butts. I'm a supporter of WHCR and their efforts to inform and entertain our community. Beloved, listen carefully to WHCR. You will be inspired, you will be informed, and you will be a better citizen and, of course, a better family member here in Harlem. Thank you.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Yes, and my name is Rick Young. This is another segment of What's in Your Hand here at WHCR 90.3 FM. We're on the campus of City College, New York City College, and in Harlem. And people are getting master's degrees, actually bachelor's degrees, master's degrees, and PhDs right here at City College. And I want to share with you a financial planning day. You heard me mention it earlier, and it's being hosted by Sybil, the Science, Industry, and Business Library. And it says, take charge of your financial future with experts. It's going to be Friday, April 29th, which is my sister's birthday, 10 a.m. to 5 p.m., so that means it's going to be a special day. They're going to have free consulting, financial credit, crisis, and Medicare, free classes on investing, Medicare, home buying, budgeting, jobs, wills, and life planning, and social security retirement. They're going to have free database demonstrations and a free financial fair. And if you want to get more information about this, and it's all free at the New York City Library, Sybil. If you want to get more information about this, you can go to 917-ASK-NYPL, which stands for New York Public Library. Or the number is 917-275-6975. They're located at 188 Madison Avenue. That's between 34th and 35th Street. And the website is nypl.org/FPD. And that's it. And I have a guest in the studio. She is, I told you how amazing she is. And if you listen, you say, wow, she's great. And I want her to read this piece for me. Element of surprise. Bing. Catch you by surprise. Gotcha.
Always surprise you. That's a good thing to be surprised.
Yeah.
Okay, you ready?
Yes, I'm ready. We are ready.
Attitude. There once was a woman who woke up one morning, looked in the mirror, and noticed she had only 3 hairs on her head. Well, she said, I think I'll braid my hair today. So she did, and she had a wonderful day. The next day she woke up, looked in the mirror, and saw that she had only 2 hairs on her head. She said, I think I'll part my hair down the middle today. So she did, and she had a grand day. The next day she woke up, looked in the mirror, and noticed that she had only 1 hair on her head. Well, she said, today I'm going to wear my hair in a ponytail. So she did, and she had a fun day. The next day she woke up, looked in the mirror, and noticed there wasn't a single hair on her head. Yay, she exclaimed. I don't have to fix my hair today. Attitude is everything. Life isn't about waiting for the storm to pass. It's about learning to dance in the rain. And that is so true.
What did you get from that, Jennifer?
Oh, you know what? Take what you have and make it work.
Okay. That's,
be
that's,
happy with
that's,
it.
That's for you.
Thank you.
I'm sure you're going to share that with some of your...
I'm going to hang it up today on a wall.
Okay.
So that anybody who passes it has the opportunity to read it. And we'll see what they do with that attitude.
So you're going to put it someplace?
I'm going to pop it up. Yep.
Okay.
I'm going to hang it up and I'm going to see how many people are affected by it. Actually, I won't see how many people are affected by it, but I'm sure at least one person will read it.
Okay. So how important is it in a person's life when they meet quality people? How important is that?
I think it's really important.
Because you met me, I want to introduce you to amazing people. That's
right.
What I want to do. I want you to meet, because you're amazing, I want you to meet other amazing people through me.
Right.
So, did I ever tell you I've been to Ireland?
Yes.
Three times. I told you that. I told you that like 12 times already, maybe 20 times. But, you know, that's something I'm proud of. I've been to Ireland three times. Not one, not two, but 3 times. I've been to Dublin.
Uh-huh.
And I've been to Belfast twice.
Wow.
So with that said, I want to introduce you to someone. I'm excited about this young lady. I'm really excited about it. She's a life coach. She's a running coach. She's a speaker. She's a co-author of a book called 20 Beautiful Women. And with that said, I'm going to bring her on. Her name is Hannah Buchanan. Or is it Hannah Lilly?
Hannah Lilly, really.
Hannah Lilly.
I go by my, Hi.
Oh, I love that Irish accent. Oh. I love it. I feel like I'm home.
I
feel like I'm home.
New York, so it's nice. I feel close to
Hannah. Hannah, I feel like I'm home, back home again.
Three times. Will you make it four? Three
yeah. Times. Oh, I love the Irish accent. Oh, man, I'm home. I'm home. I'm
good
home.
Morning, Hannah.
A kid from Harlem. A kid from Harlem is hanging out in Ireland. I'm hanging out with Barry McQuiggan, the clone of Cyclone, the great boxing champion from Ireland. I'm hanging out with Barry.
Oh, fantastic. Fantastic.
Let me tell you, let me take a station ID real quick. I'm going to tell you a quick story with Barry.
Yeah.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Ladies and gentlemen, Rick Young, What's in Your Hand, in the studio, Jennifer Ryan, on the phone, Hannah, Lily. Hannah, so I'm in the car, we're leaving the gym. Barry and I, we're leaving the gym, and we're going to the house where they had me staying. It was a house where the lady, you know, she cooks your breakfast and your lunch and everything. It's like, what do you call those houses? Like a
Guest house.
A guest house, yeah.
Guest house, yeah.
Nice guest, it was nice. First thing, when I got there the first night, it was so cold in there. I was like, I think I slept with my clothes on. It was so cold in there. So I put the windows down under the covers, and I woke up, it was nice and warm in the morning. I said, yeah, okay, I'm okay now. It's warm in here. When I came back the next evening, the window was up again. I was like, oh, man. But I eventually got used to it. So real quick, so I'm leaving the gym with Barry McQuiggan.
Yeah.
And he's got this, you know, car, sports car. And he starts driving. He's got these little small streets in Belfast. And he's cutting, he's driving. I said, whoa, 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 whoa. I said, let me out, man. Let me out. I want to make it back home. You're not going to. I said, no, I didn't know where I was. I said, let me out. I'll walk to wherever. Let me out. And he literally stopped because he was going fast. He was cutting these corners. And he had a stick shift. I was like, oh, no. No, 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 no. You're not going to read about me in the paper in Ireland. I said, no. Let me out, man. And he stopped. Thank God for that. He stopped. So Hannah, co-author of 20 Beautiful Women. 20 stories that will heal your soul, ignite your passion, and inspire your divine purpose. Wow.
Well, it's 20 stories from women around the world, mostly actually American women, but all women who have faced adversity in various.
Mostly what kind of women?
Women from all over the world, but they've all faced adversity.
Okay.
At some point in their life, and all from in very different scenarios, and it's about how they've overcome it and moving forward to live their best lives. So it's a collection of stories that one will touch everybody, you know, in some way or another. And it's an inspiring, positive read. So it's been brilliant to be a part of that and have my story featured in it.
So you're a life coach?
Yeah, I'm a coach and I'm a running coach. I coach beginners how to run, people who can't run at all, to be able to run sort of 5K, 3 miles.
Wow.
Yeah, and I'm a speaker, but across everything that I do, and I write as well, but across everything that I do, the kind of the key, the core of it is that it's about helping people believe in themselves and see the real person that they are. And like that brilliant quote that Jennifer said earlier about making the best of what you have, finding the good in what you have, rather than, as we so often do, focusing on the negative.
Now, were you born in Ireland?
No, I was born in London.
Okay.
But I moved here when I was 12 years old, so I've been here longer than I was in England.
So have you ever been to Belfast before?
I have, yeah, a long time ago.
When I went there, Barry fought in a place called the King's Hall.
Yes, yeah, I know,
Yeah. So, Hannah, one of the things that I want to learn, I know Jennifer kind of knows this already, but I want to learn how to turn negatives in the positive, and you teach that, right?
Yeah, well, I began an experiment last year that really that's what it was based around. It began as an experiment simply to try and feel better about myself and my life, and that was the key core of it, was to try and do what I could to start seeing the positive in all things rather than the negative in things. And it came about because I had reached a point in my own life where I was really I had hit my rock bottom, and my self-worth was really, really low. I didn't like to look at myself in the mirror. All I could see was the negatives in my life. And so it reached a point that I just thought, I have to try and do something about this. And I decided that I wanted to try and do things that would, I call them joy triggers, things that would, like, help me feel better. Because when you feel, if you feel bad or you're stuck in a negative cycle, you're depressed, you're anxious, any of these things, it's not as easy as just being told, you know, snap out of it. So I wanted things that would trigger a positive reaction in me. So I created a list of rules or joy triggers to follow on a daily basis.
So this experiment, this was a six-month experiment?
It was a six-month experiment, yeah. And it really began, literally, like I said, just as a way of just to try and feel better, anyway better. I just, like, I felt so bad that I could not have felt any worse. So I thought, you know, anything up the scale would have been a positive. But it turned out to be, I suppose what it became was a journey of becoming my friend. And the core of it was in seeing the positive in who I was. And then that enabled me to see the positive in all that was around me.
Wait a second. Did you just say that you became your friend? Did you just say that?
Yeah, that's what I said. Yeah. I became my friend. Yeah.
Wait a minute. Let me check in with Jennifer on this one. Jennifer, you heard what she said? She said she wanted to become her friend.
Yep.
Jennifer, can you speak to that?
I am my friend.
You are your friend.
I don't talk to myself the way I would talk to a stranger. I only talk to myself the way I would talk to a stranger or somebody I love dearly. I don't talk to myself in a way that I wouldn't speak to them. Meaning, I look in the mirror and say, oh, you ate so bad yesterday. What's wrong with you? I don't say that. I say, you know, you enjoyed yourself a little too much yesterday.
Yeah.
And today, you're going to take care of yourself a little bit better. And give a positive push instead of beating myself up. Why am I going to beat myself up? Why do I have that tendency to be negative? And Hannah, everybody goes where you were.
Yeah.
At some point, we are humans and we all go there. And it's the courage, my favorite word in the world, courage
yeah.
to do that joy trigger, to find that list that's going to make you wake up and say, I got to feel better and I'm in charge of that and I'm worth it.
Yeah, the responsibility, yeah, and knowing that that's it, that you do deserve that, and everybody walking this earth.
I am my doctor.
Yeah, is meant to be, and there is meant to be in living a life of joy. But the positive for anybody who's in that really dark place, which, you know, everybody, or almost everybody meets at some stage, is
yes.
that it's a pathway through that is where all the joy is. It's on the other side of it, and by getting through it. But being a friend, I always say, the joy is on the other side of the fear, but it's much easier. It's not easy to get through the fear, but it's easier to get through the fear when you're your friend rather than dragging an enemy around with you the whole time.
Wow, interesting. Now, Hannah, do you talk to yourself?
Well, I do. Now, I'm so aware. That was one of the first things I became aware of when I began my experiment, was of how badly I talked to myself. And it was quite a shock. That when I really started to examine it and see that I was really bringing around with me all day, no matter what I did, somebody who was telling me that it wasn't, you know, my own mind was telling me it's not good enough, you need to do better, and always criticizing. So, you know what, I kind of catch myself. If I feel myself sinking into a bit of an anxiety, I just say, you know, why is this? What are you giving yourself a hard time over? What are you worried about that you're... And it really always comes back to trying to be perfect in some way. And I remember, oh, you know, it doesn't matter. You're good enough as you are. And it's, it's much easier. Life is much, much nicer when you're a friend to yourself. And it really is the key to the door to joy, I feel, definitely.
And you met Jack Canfield.
I did, yes, yeah.
What was that experience like?
Yeah, it was an amazing experience.
Well, first of all, who is Jack Canfield, and what was that experience like?
Sorry, I just didn't quite catch you there.
And I said, who is Jack Canfield?
Well, Jack Canfield is like a multi-bestselling author. One of the most common known is Chicken Soup for the Soul.
Right.
And he's also written The Success Principles, and he has big goals and big missions to help as many people over the world. He was originally in the book The Secret,
right.
Also. Help people empower themselves and live their best lives. So he's a very successful author and speaker, and he coaches too.
So I saw a picture of you reading The Secret. Is that a book that you enjoy? Yeah,
I had read The Secret actually in about August 2013, I suppose it was. I had read The Secret. I was at quite a stressful stage in my life then, and I was just about to compete in a bikini competition and a bodybuilding competition. So, and I was busy, I was self-employed, and I was feeling quite stressed, and I had these big goals of being a speaker and all sorts, but I wasn't sure how I was going to get there. And this friend said to me, oh, this is book The Secret, have you ever heard of it? And I actually had heard of it years before, and I hadn't really been interested in it. But that night I read it, and at the time, that's when I first began practicing gratitude. It was my first, you know, these light bulb moments that you have, of that, oh, I have a responsibility in my own life. I have an element of control in how things go. And I thought that my life was going fantastic. So I felt a lot better than I had, a lot less stressed. I competed. I gave my first ever motivational talk. But it was actually then, the months following the competition, that I actually began my descent to what I would call, yeah, my rock bottom, which was when I started to realize that all my self-worth was based in how my body looked, in my external achievements, and it's when I started to realize that the relationship I had with myself was not a good one. And so then I stopped practicing anything I had read in The Secret, and I had about 3 months when I didn't really want to leave my house, like I was saying earlier. But so what happened when I finally decided I didn't want to live anymore, which is an awful way to feel. And it was that I just thought, you have to, you know, try and do something. And that was when kind of the little spark, that I remembered The Secret, and I thought, oh, you know, it helped. Gratitude had made a difference to my life back then when I was, you know, a bit stressed about bills and things like that. I wonder, will it work? I wonder, will things like gratitude and kindness and visualization, will these things work on a big scale like this?
Right. Hannah, I want to read something. So hold on a second. I want to read something really quick.
Lovely.
And Jennifer, I want to see how you feel about this, what I'm about to say. It says, you are not your body. Job, home, car, relationship, mistakes, regrets, or fears. You are the sparkle in love you were born with. Look within. When you hear that, Jennifer, what becomes present for you?
Well, I think about what we talked about earlier is stuff. That's all stuff. That's not who you are.
You are not your body, job, home, car, relationships, mistakes, regrets, or fears.
That's stuff. And that's the stuff I work on with clients. I work on with myself.
Yeah.
These things are not important. Who you are inside is important, because that's what you have, that's what you will always be, that's your integrity, that's your character, and it's what you have to give.
Mm-hmm. So, Hannah, that's Jennifer responding to this piece I'm reading, and you know who wrote that piece?
Yeah, me. Me.
Yeah. So, give me some feedback on that piece that you wrote.
It's because it's so easy.
The tweet, that's on Twitter. That's the kind of tweets I like.
Sorry?
I said that's the kind of tweets I like. Positive tweets on Twitter.
Yeah, they're the kind of tweets I like. Yeah. It's so easy in the society that we live in, and the way that we're raised even is to look for joy and fulfillment in everything that's external. That's how we're taught, that things are in the success. They're in the grades that we get in school. They're in the way that our bodies look, the amount of money we have, all these things. So it becomes like this constant search for something outside of ourselves, the best relationship, you know, all these things that we're going to keep find it, and then we're going to experience this fulfillment and this peace and this joy. And what I realized from my own experience was that all along that fulfillment and that peace and that joy, it was already there, because we come with it. We're born with that. And what happens is we just start to lose touch with it. So it wasn't so much a case of having to create something new, but just to rediscover, which is, I'm writing my own book now, which is called The Joy Hunt, because it's about hunting back for that joy that's inside us. And it cannot come from anything external, because all these things external, like the little story there about the woman with the hairs, they're not lasting. We can't keep them. If we put all our attachments into something on the outside,
okay,
the balance tends to tip. At some stage, you lose one of them.
Well, let me ask you, Hannah, how important is it for you to meet new and good and great people. How important is that for you?
Oh, I just think it's fantastic. I don't think you can have enough of meeting other people who have, and hearing their experiences and surrounding yourself with people who are on a similar wavelength and who are positive. It just feeds and feeds.
That's
how the world changes.
Yeah, I don't know why you were supposed to meet Jennifer, but you guys definitely need to exchange information. Yeah. Let me have your website again.
Oh, well, my website is hannah-lily.com.
Uh-huh.
And that's my blog at the moment. That's when you go there, you'll access my personal blog. That's as far as I've got so far with my website development.
And can they contact you through the blog?
Yeah, you can contact me through the blog or also at hannahlilyfitness@gmail.com. That's probably the easiest.
Okay. Hold on a second. People. Hold on a second, Hannah.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Ladies and gentlemen, Rick Young. The show is What's in Your Hand. My guest in studio, Jennifer Ryan, professional organizer and motivational coach. And her website is createneworder.com. Hannah, did you get that? Createneworder.com.
I did. Yeah, I'm writing it down here now.
And my other guest on the line is Hannah Lily, calling me all the way from Ireland. What part of Ireland are you from, Hannah?
I'm in, Ireland's so tiny, like, we'd probably fit Ireland into one state in New York. So I'm in Westmeath, which is in the Midlands, but I'm about 45 minutes away from Dublin.
Ah.
So that's kind of the easiest.
Okay.
I'll get to the airport in 50 minutes.
I wish I was in Ireland with you right now. I really do.
Well, will you get over for a fourth time?
Yeah, I got to hit number four. I got to do number four.
Yeah, definitely do, and let me know.
Well, my son wants to live there, so.
Your son wants to live in Ireland.
Yeah, talk to Hannah. Yeah, my family, my great-grandfather came over from Limerick.
Ryan, Ryan is an Irish name.
Ron
Ryan.
Yeah, and apparently my family, there's still distant cousins there, so.
Right, you'll have to come over. And I'd like to get to New York, so.
Well, welcome anytime, and we'll get together when you get here.
So, Hannah, I'm going to go back to this six-month experiment. So, like, what made you, like, I know, okay, you were going through a difficult time, but what did that experiment look like?
Well, I decided that I'd start on the 4th of February, 2014, because I thought it was rather than it being like a New Year's resolution, I started it month later. I created rules that I follow, 10 rules that I decided I would follow daily. Now, rule number 10 of this was that I would blog about it honestly, and I said I'd be honest from the beginning, but that it also wouldn't pressure myself to be perfect. So I had these 10 rules to follow, and they were all small things that didn't require any money to do. They were just things I could start in my own home. One was to create a gratitude list. So instead of getting up first thing in the morning, where I had up to then been waking, feeling anxious, negative, another day, just the same, and, and all the right, I was having to wake up and think about, okay, I'm going to write 3 things on my gratitude list. And even if in the beginning those 3 things were, I have a house, I'm alive, and I have toothpaste, it didn't matter. They didn't have to be really... they didn't have to be really big, amazing things. If it was just, that tiny spark, it's amazing. Because I was speaking to someone the other day, and they said, it's very hard to be grateful when you're feeling negative. And I said, but it's actually very hard to feel negative when you're being grateful. And it just, by making it something that I had to do, it immediately just tipped the balance for the day. If you imagine that you're carrying 2 bags, one in each arm, and one is full of negative thoughts and one is full of positive, the minute just being grateful, it just tipped the positivity just that bit more. I would start my day listening to a song that I liked, a piece of music. That was just, one thing. I would start the day, put on a piece of music that I liked. Something I started to do with my children. And again, straight away, and there was an uplift and in my mood, in the way I felt. Fresh air, every day fresh air, I would say, even if it meant standing outside my door and just looking at the sky. Or if I was going for a run, these were things that I knew made a positive difference to me. And one of my rules was to aim to try and find positivity rather than negativity in thoughts and conversations and actions. And it just very quickly transformed the way I felt.
Hey, Hannah, I want you to define peace. What does peace mean to you, peace?
Peace is just a knowing that you're enough and that all is well, regardless of what is going on around you. It's a no longer needing control. And it's just a knowing that everything is exactly as it's meant to be.
And Jennifer, what is your definition of peace?
Freedom. It's freedom. It's
freedom.
It's freedom. Peace is freedom. It's just it. And like Hannah just said, you know, the sense of control, but the release of it, you know,
yeah.
Get that control off of you is, you know, what I said before. You know, I read something this morning that, you know, depression is living in the past, anxiety is living in the future, and peace is living in the present.
Yeah. I mean, peace is the present moment, isn't it? Peace is being able, when you experience that amazing feeling of just being now,
And just the comfort in that, the comfort, the security in that, and just knowing that this is good. It is good.
Hey, Hannah, could chaos be going on all around you, and can you still be in peace?
Yeah, I think it's definitely achievable, and I think that's one of the hardest things to achieve, and it's about finding the balance, but definitely the more at peace you are with yourself, the less you need your surroundings to be, you know, what we would perceive as peaceful or controlled. So when you have that calm inside of you and you can be in the moment, whatever that moment is, then you can be peaceful in chaos.
Listen to this, Hannah. This is gonna blow your mind. So one day, it was not dark, but it was like dawn. It was starting to get dark, but not quite dark. Still a little bit of light. And so, at the time, I was doing a little running. So I was like, okay, let me run. Let me get out and run, you know. And it started raining. And I went out anyway. And I ran. And it was raining. And Central Park is a huge park.
Yeah. But
the part I was running in, nobody was out there. Like, nobody. Like, I think I saw one guy. I think I might have saw like three people from a distance. And it was just me. And I'm running, Hannah. Now you with me? I'm running.
Yeah.
And then I just went into this euphoric zone. And I started saying stuff like to myself, like positive, motivational, whatever I could think of. Yeah, you're the best. You're the greatest. Yeah, I was screaming. Yeah. Like, yeah. And I'm running. And it, man, that feeling, if I could have that anytime I want, that was amazing.
Yeah.
And the rain and the dawn, it was just like a perfect, and no one was out there. It was just me. It was peace and serenity, and I was running. It was like, whoa.
I feel it's amazing. Yeah.
It
is amazing, and that feeling cannot be got from anything other than yourself and this amazing world that we live in. You know, the when you see, that's why I say, you know, when you go outside and you look at the sky, you feel the rain, or you just realize that it's something so much bigger than just us. But it's all work. It wants to work with you to bring you to the best place.
Now, Hannah, Jennifer was talking about, you know, she's a professional organizer, right?
Yeah.
So she was talking about stuff, right? Well, I have this book, old book, that I've had for years. And I just thought about it just now. I'm going to go home and get that book and look through it. And the name of the book is called The Running Mind.
All right, yeah.
Beautiful book. So, Jennifer, I'm going to go to you on this one. So we talk about stuff. A book like that, you would say read it, give it away. But now I can go back to that book.
Right.
Because I have it.
Well, I don't say give away everything. I have my own collection of books to go back to that
you have
inspired
a library.
Me. Yes, I have a small library in my home. And I'm very
selective.
I'm very selective of what I keep. And I keep things that I do refer back to that inspired me or gave me information that's important to reflect back on. So I do keep things. I don't just get rid of stuff. I help you understand the stuff that makes you feel good, that sustains your life, that looks good, and makes you feel good. You know, it's about being at peace and being genuine to yourself.
Well, knowing that I have that book
right.
makes me feel good, because I can know I can go, and I hadn't read it in years, mm-hmm. but now I can go back and look at it and be refreshed again.
That's right. You know, stuff becomes hazardous, you know, when we fall on it, or, you know, it does us bodily harm, you know, but when it does good, you want to give that priority, and you want to give it a place, you know, and honor that thing that makes you a better person.
Hannah, do you have a library?
I wouldn't say it's as organized as a library, but I have a collection of books, yeah, that I turn to, you know, that I like, that I...
Wait a minute.
Get inspiration from. And then I like to pass Wait. Things on that I know I won't read again, or I know no one else in my house will read again.
Oh, Hannah, I got to scold you. I don't know. I can't get it all. You don't have a library, Hannah? Are you kidding me?
I have a lot of books, but I wouldn't call it as organized as a library.
Oh, no.
That's what a library brings to me, a very lovely room just for the books.
We're going to come to Ireland and get you.
Yeah, you can.
You got to have a library. I even got a library, Hannah.
And is a library a whole room for just the books, or?
Yeah.
No.
Oh, yeah. No, not yet. Not yet. I'm not there yet. I have probably enough books for a library, but
it could just be a bookshelf.
I've done over 700 shows. You think I'm gonna have a corner of books?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
I got a bookstore.
I'm quite good, actually. I have to say at passing things, you know, at moving things along.
Okay.
I don't hold on to an awful lot of.
A lot of things. My books are signed.
Oh, that's nice.
Oh, well then, yeah, that's lovely. Nice.
Some
yeah.
of them are signed.
So that's more office. Than a library, because that's also a collection.
Yeah.
Yeah, but, you know, yeah, but then,
that's
yeah.
that's different. That's elevated.
Yeah.
That's okay. elevated. But I pass my books on as well. Yeah. You know, books that I'm not going to keep. And of course, the public library is where I want all the books to be. So if I need one, I can go back and get one.
So, Hannah, before you came on, I played a song called Ball of Confusion. And people are not, they're not having peace right now. Some people are not, you know, we got this stuff going on in the U.S. with all this election stuff going on.
Yeah.
They're fighting, they're biting, they're cussing, they're doing, I mean, and I've never seen anything like this before. It's never, none of them have seen anything like this before.
Yeah.
People running for president saying all type of.
Crazy things.
Crazy things, bad words and this and that. And. Hannah, so a lot of people are not at peace. They, you know, oh, everybody's angry. The country's so messed up. Everybody's angry, you know, fueling that anger. What do you say to people that just don't have peace within themselves and they're in a ball of confusion right now?
Well, I think it can seem quite overwhelming sometimes when we look at the world and all the things that are going on, and that's when it becomes tempting to just say, oh, well, it makes no difference. It's too hard.
Just throw your hands up.
It's too hard to do anything other than this, because look at what our leaders are doing, look at what, you know, all the fighting in the world, all these things. It's never going to, you know, and that is just on a grand scale focusing on the massive negative. And it's the fact is that each person themselves, it makes a difference. It really does. Okay, one person today deciding to be grateful is not going to change what some of these presidential candidates are saying to each other today, but it will make a difference to their life. And it's about taking the responsibility for your own life, regardless of what other people are doing, and making the decision that you want it to be better. And I think, like, if you think of the life that you would like this world to be living, or the way you'd like this world to be, then live the life that you would live in that world, and live the life that people need to live in order for that to come. It's the fact that one small person does make a difference.
So, speaking of one small person makes a difference, what could a little girl from Ireland, actually from London, but we're going to just say Ireland.
Let's say it, yeah.
We're going to say Ireland. This little girl from Ireland and this little boy from Harlem and this rich girl from Long Island. Three of them get together. What could they do, Hannah? What could they do to empower the world? What could they do?
Well, I think, like, live by example and share with people and help people feel excited about the fact that things can be better. Like, it can be better for them in their own lives, and it can be better for this world in a grander scale. And it's share what's worked for you, everything you're doing, interviewing people, speaking to people. What I did mightn't work for everybody, but something from it might make a positive difference. Every tiny little difference that happens in somebody's life, it just ripples out and reaches and touches so many people.
So, Hannah, I'm gonna dedicate this song to that little boy from Harlem, that little girl from Ireland, and that rich girl from Long Island. I'm going to dedicate this song to you. Let's see if we can get this rolling. What can we do?
We're going to change the world.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I believe it's not too late. Together we can change the world. Lay the puzzle pieces out. Find out what it's all about. Together we can change the world.
Together we can change the world. So, Hannah, I'm not going to play the whole song. So what did you get from that song, Hannah?
Well, that's it. We really can. Together we can change the world. That's it. By making positive changes and positive steps, no matter how small they seem, a positive step is in the right direction. It'll ripple out. If it ripples out to one member of your family, and then it ripples out to their friends.
But so Hannah... He's just a little boy from Harlem. How's he? She's just a little girl from Ireland.
It doesn't matter. Live bravely and live with love, and only good can come from that.
Jennifer, what became present for you when you heard that song?
It's true. We can do it one small piece at a time.
Together we can change.
And what Hannah just said, you know, you do things with love. If you do things with the right intention, even if they don't work out exactly the way you thought they would, you do them with that intention. You do them with love. It will make a difference to someone. Somewhere, it will improve and will get better. You know, this little boy from Harlem, this rich girl from Long Island, this little girl from Ireland, just connecting the three of us. And, you know, the triangle, the delta is my logo, and it's three. Things come in three, and they keep connecting, keep connecting, keep connecting, and they make change. And we can change with positive attitudes. Yes, positive mental attitude on the back of Rick's shirt.
Yeah.
PMA.
So, but... Tell me how you got into personal development, Hannah. Tell me that story again, how you got into personal development.
Well, it's been from my own experience, and I've been kind of just working people. It just happened naturally that more and more people wanted to hear about what I had done myself. And it became, like, it's my intention, I suppose, is to share the message, is to share with people what is possible and to help people believe in themselves and create that positive relationship with themselves so that they can have a positive relationship with life. And so it's just sort of snowballed, and my main kind of goals are to speak more. That's my and share more.
If you come to New York, you got to look me up. We got to make something happen.
I will, yeah.
Have you ever met Rhonda Byrne?
I've never met her, no.
Okay.
Have you?
No, I have not. No. I have not. I met a few people that have been in that film, The Secret.
Yes.
Bob Proctor I met, Jack Canfield, and a few others. Well, actually, yes, I didn't meet Jack, but I interviewed him on the phone.
Oh, right. Yeah.
But Bob, I met him in person, and I interviewed him. So, very, very good. Very good film.
Yes.
Did you like that film?
I have seen it only once. I think it's all something that definitely does work, but I do really believe that the most important thing of all is the relationship that you have with yourself, and that when you work on that, that it's possible to manifest things into your life, money and success and various things, but I don't feel that you get the peace and the joy until you've got the relationship with yourself worked on first.
Hannah, I have to say we're at the end already. That was fast, right?
That flew by, yeah. We could talk all day, I think.
Yes, we got to do this again.
Yeah, well, thank you so much. It's
give
been
me
a pleasure to speak to you both.
I want you to, I was a boxer, you know, I was with Barry. So I want you to hit me with something positive, with a positive message to walk with. I want you to hit me with a positive message.
Hit you with a positive message. Well,
James Brown used to say, hit me.
I would say that all the joy that you need is on the other side of fear. And it's easier to walk through that fear when you've got a friend in you.
Wow. Jennifer, can you give us a positive message? I want you to hit me with a positive message.
The positive message today is grace. Is find the grace in your movement. Grace means the refinement of movement. So find the grace in your movement toward joy.
Wow. Wow. With that said,
thank you.
Hannah, thank you for being here today.
Thank you for having me. Have a fantastic day. Set your intention for an amazing day. You're going to have.
That's right.
You too.
And I saw you were from Ireland. I said, okay, you know, I got to connect with her. When I saw you were from Ireland. The other thing that today, Jennifer and I is doing a challenge. We're going to have a day of peace within us, no matter what goes on around us. I know it's probably going to be easy for you. It might be a little challenging for me, but no matter what goes on, no matter what somebody says or anything, we're going to have a day of peace.
Yeah, but I'm with you on that.
You're going to join us too, the three of us?
I'm going to join you on that, yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
So I got to make sure you get Jennifer's contact information. Do you do texting?
Yeah. Sorry?
Do you do texting?
Texting, yeah, I do, yeah.
So, okay, I'm going to make sure you get Jennifer's information, and Jennifer, you're going to get Hannah's information.
And yeah, I'm on Twitter as well, at Hannah Lilly, so that's it.
Hannah Lilly.
Yeah, Hannah Lilly.
Okay.
Yeah. Fantastic.
Hannah, thank you for being here today, calling all the way from Ireland. What time is it there now?
It is midday. It's nearly 1 o'clock now.
It's a five-hour difference.
We're 5 hours, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. So have a wonderful day, both of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'll talk to you again soon. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Okay. Wow, Snake, I didn't want to let her go.
Uh-huh.
Jennifer, we're at the end. Thank you for being here today.
Oh,
I appreciate
thanks for
you.
Having me. It's
get
always
up
fun.
Early. Yeah, you meet amazing people.
Every time.
You got to connect.
Oh, I am definitely going to connect with Hannah.
It's got to.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, it's got to happen because you don't know what could happen, like who she knows that you could help. Or who she knows that could help you, or who you know that could help her.
And she, you know what? She's so inspiring because her journey and her goal when she was picking herself back up was to live honestly.
Right.
And that's so important, and I'm so inspired by that because that is a message for all of us to hear.
Awesome. All right. And don't forget, Financial Planning Day, April 29th, 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. at the Science Industry Business Library, Sybil, 188 Madison Avenue at 34th Street, between 34th and 35th Street, April 29th. All right. You guys have a magnificent week. I'll see you next Friday with another incredible show.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Come on.
Yeah.
You're listening to WHCR 90.3 FM, the voice of Harlem.
Don't touch that dial. Keep it locked on WHCR 90.3 FM, the voice of Harlem.
This is a journey into sound.
We are on the air.
Keep this frequency clear.
Do not attempt to adjust your dial.
Don't touch that dial.